Hi, this is Chris Widener, president of Made for Success, and I want to welcome you to this message, Bringing Balance to a Chaotic Life. And the first thing I want to do is just say thanks. Thanks for purchasing this and taking the opportunity to grow as a person and to build into your own life, to listen to some ideas and some thoughts that I believe can truly help you to take that life of yours and make it better. You'll notice when you go to our website or see our printed material, it says, Made for Success, Charting the Course to a Better Life. And that's what I hope the little bit of time that I'm going to spend with you today is going to be able to do. It's going to be able to chart for you the course to a better life. So let's get started. Bringing balance to a chaotic life. First thing I want to do is just tell you a little bit of a story here. It's apocryphal, obviously, as you'll see, but there's a story of the Pope coming to New York City, and he gets to New York City, and he's driving along in his limousine, and all of a sudden, he starts remembering about what life was like before he was the Pope. You know, he used to be able to drive his own car, and he actually enjoyed driving his own car, and so he gets on the phone to the front seat and says, hey, driver, pull over. I want to drive for a little while. So they pull over, and he gets in the front seat, and he's driving. And he's going along, and he's just fiddling with the windows and rolling the windows up and down and opening the sunroof. And he's got a 6-CD changer. He's changing the CDs. He's listening to music, just really enjoying himself. Well, the problem is that he runs a red light, and he gets pulled over by one of New York City's finest. And the policeman comes up to the window, and the window rolls down. And, of course, it's hard to miss the Pope with the hat and everything. And so this policeman looks into the window at who he'd pulled over, and he says, hold on, just hold on. I need to go back to my patrol car. So he goes back to his patrol car, and he gets on the radio, and he says, I need to speak to the police chief. Let me talk to the police chief. So they patch him through to the police chief. And the chief says, what do you need, patrolman? And he says, well, I got to tell you, I've pulled over one big fish here. I mean, I've pulled over one big fish. And he says, well, did you pull over the mayor of New York City? He says, no, bigger than that. And he says, bigger than that? You didn't pull over the governor of New York State, did you? He says, no, much bigger than that. And he says, oh, my goodness, did you pull over the president of the United States motorcade? And he says, no, chief, much, much bigger than that. And he says, bigger than that? Who'd you pull over? And he says, I don't know who I pulled over, but this guy's so big he's got the Pope for a chauffeur. Now, that story I really like, number one, because it's funny, but number two, because there's actually a moral behind it. And the moral of that story is that things are not always as they appear. And one of the things I've noticed as I've worked with successful people throughout the years is that on the outside, we might see that they're very successful, that they've got good finances and good families and those kinds of things. But inwardly, and if you were able to look past perhaps just their work situation, you'd see that there really is a chaotic life going on behind just the outer image. And so one of the things that I've committed my life to doing as I chart this course to a better life is helping people bring balance to a chaotic life. Now, I want to tell you a little bit of my story to see how I've gotten to where I'm at today. I grew up in the Seattle, Washington area in the United States. I mention that because we do have listeners and subscribers to our newsletter in literally tens of countries at this point. The latest number I had was 68 countries, and we're shipping tapes literally all over the world. And so Seattle, Washington in the United States is where I grew up. My dad died when I was 4 years old, and I was raised by a single mom, made life chaotic. I took care of myself much of the time. I'd come home. I was what they call a latchkey kid. I think even before they invented the term, I was a latchkey kid. I dealt with a lot of issues growing up, anger and some bitterness and some things like that, so much so that I was sent away from my family to live with some other folks who they thought that they could get to kind of get my life in order as a kid. Then I also became involved with drugs and alcohol later on in my teen years. which was very detrimental to me. And I was really just kind of drifting and in this chaotic lifestyle of no purpose and just wondering what my life would be like. And then when I was 17, I had a spiritual awakening. I decided to rechange my direction. I went to college where I majored in youth and family. I wanted to help kids that were like me. I also wanted to help families to be able to find balance and to find peace and to find direction and purpose for their lives. And the first place out of college that I ended up was in northern New Jersey, which is just outside of New York City. And I was involved with very successful people in a worldly sense, very successful financially, etc. And one of the things that I noticed as I saw two different kinds of people out there was that oftentimes they would achieve financial success, but they had this chaotic life and families were falling apart and people were having issues in their lives and they were not able to experience much of a life, really, in a broad definition. But I also saw that there were certain people who proved the point that you could have a fast-paced life and achieve success and those kinds of things and have balance in their life. And it revolved a lot around priorities and things that we're going to talk about in this message. I moved from New Jersey back out to the Seattle area where I'm also currently living. And I, again, work with successful people who've achieved some level of success in their life financially and in that sense. And one of my goals is to help people like yourself who is listening to this message to be able to bring some balance into their life. How do you achieve in different areas of your life without allowing them to pull one direction or another and to cause the other areas of your life to sacrifice in? I want you to think with me now and compare and contrast two different situations. Family, say back in the mid-1800s, and compare and contrast that with a family today in our situation. Now, 150 years ago, what were the opportunities that a family could pursue when they woke up in the morning? Well, they had a few options. They could get up and stay home, or they could get up and go work in the fields and take care of the livestock. Now, what was their opportunity when work was done for the day? Well, they could sit at home and read, or they could sit at home and maybe play games or sing songs or something like that, or they could go to bed. The opportunities available 150 years ago were very finite. They were very limited in terms of what our opportunities were. Life wasn't particularly chaotic back then. But let's compare and contrast that to life today. What are our options when we get up in the morning? Well, our options are almost limitless. They're almost infinite. We have almost infinite opportunities of how we can spend our lives each and every day. We could get up and go down to the airport and get on an airplane and within 24 hours be anywhere in the world. We can buy things. We can buy it over the internet. We can go to the store. We can do it over the phone. We can buy things. We can do commerce. We can go to work. There's hundreds of opportunities for us to spend our time in regard to recreational activities. We can go swimming. We can work out at the health club. We can go to a game. We can go skiing. Almost virtually infinite opportunities. And with those opportunities, which are great things, I mean, I think people who lived 150 years ago would love to live now and to be able to have the opportunities that we have, that technology has created for us. They're great things. But with that, with the opportunities, it's created for us enormous pressure. Because what creates in us a chaotic life is trying to live all these different opportunities and being unable to limit them and to choose which ones we want to participate in and to limit our involvement with some of the opportunities so that other opportunities we want to pursue are not neglected and the like. And so we live in a world with near infinite opportunities. And that's the only reason we have to have things like bringing balance to a chaotic life. And so on one hand, it's exciting time to live, and it's great things to involve ourselves in and to participate in. But on the other hand, we now more than ever have to focus in and take charge of our lives. And we have to bring balance to a chaotic life. Our lives are not going to naturally bring balance and be lived in balance. They're going to naturally spin out of control, and we'll end up living these chaotic lives. So before we start and get into some real practical areas, I want to tell you my goals for the next bit of time that we have. The first one is that I want to provide motivation for you. That's what I see my role as the president of Made for Success, is to provide people with motivation, because a lot of times people know how to do things. They know how to lose weight or how to make money or those kinds of things. And what we really need to do, the key, is to provide motivation for people, to help them understand the reasons behind wanting to do these things. I want to motivate you to bring balance to your chaotic life, to show you what a good life can be like, to show you the benefits that you would receive as you live that kind of life. A second goal of mine is to give you simple, practical steps. Now, one of the things that you'll hear me say quite often, if you listen to any of our tapes or messages that you get from the website or you might purchase from us, is that success is simple, but it's often difficult. And I believe that the things that we're going to talk about today in terms of bringing balance to a chaotic life are simple. They're simple things. The whole idea is actually a relatively simple thing. And a lot of what we're going to talk about today are things that you will say, yeah, I know that. But we're going to give you some simple practical steps to use. The difficult part comes in actually doing them. Many of us know the things that we ought to do, but we just don't do them. I do, however, want to give you some simple practical steps. For some of them, they'll be new to you, and some of them, they'll just be a reminder to you. I heard somebody say one time, people need to be reminded a lot more than they need to be instructed, and that's very true. We do need to be reminded of these principles. That's one of my goals, to give you some simple practical steps to bringing your life into balance. The third thing is to be a catalyst for thought and action. And that's sort of combining those two things, the motivation and the simple practical steps. I want to be a catalyst. I want you to stop when you listen to this, to leave and to actually go and do something, to make an immediate change in your life. A lot of times people buy tapes or CDs and they'll listen to them and they'll get all motivated and then they never do anything. They don't actually apply it. They don't change their life. They don't stop smoking. They don't lose weight. They don't do any of those things. They hear it, they know it, and then they don't do it. My goal is for you to not only think about these things, but to create in your life an action that will enable you to see yourself pulled back out of the chaotic life and into the balanced life. Now, I want to tell you, this is serious stuff. I work with families and have for the last 11 years who achieve a lot in this world, but realize that there are things that are more important than just financial success. Financial success is great, and I would consider it a blessing, but there are things that are more important, and that is a balanced life. And I've worked with people who've achieved quite a bit of financial success, whose marriages fail, and whose children end up going astray. And so one of my goals is for us to understand that what we're talking about here is serious business. It's all about life and the important things of life. And if we can help you to get into a mindset where you can earn more money or lose some weight or those kind, that's great. But above all, my goal is to help people at the end of their lives say, I had a good life in all areas of my life, spiritually, financially, emotionally, intellectually, relationally, I had a good life. And that's my goal. This is serious stuff. And I want to help change lives. That's why I do what I do, because I'm hoping that this message will change your life, that there will be a different direction in your life when you're done listening to it. So let's talk about the primary issues involved, the primary issues of bringing balance to a chaotic life. The first issue is that we need to see the big picture. It's what I just talked about a little bit. Oftentimes we get focused in on smaller sub-segments of life, and we focus all of our attention and time and energy into that area of our life. We get set on making money, and we focus everything on going on that, and we work to the detriment of our health or the detriment of our family or whatever. Other people, they get focused in on achieving, great health. They're working out 2-3 hours a day. And, you know, you've seen these pictures of guys and gals with just massive muscles. Well, that takes time to be able to achieve that kind of body. And what that does is it takes away time from other areas, and we can become focused in on a very small area. What I'm encouraging us to do, if we're going to be able to bring balance, is you have to step back from your particular area. And we all have these bents of ours that we are sort of bent toward becoming out of balance. For some, it's family. For some, it's work. For some, it's health, recreation, whatever. But to step back from those and say, okay, there is a bigger picture here. There's a broader scheme of things than just the one area of my life that I've spent so much time focusing in on. So that's the first thing. One of the primary issues is to see the big picture. The second thing is to understand the magnitude of life. It's to be able to see how big life is and how broad of a spectrum it is when we understand that our lives affect other people's lives, which affect other people's lives, and how they spread out and affect such a broad magnitude. You know, if our lives are not in balance, then our kids' lives, as they grow up, they'll see that and they'll say, well, that's the way life is lived. And they'll spend time pursuing the things that we pursued or something like that. Or what they may do is they say, I don't want to do that. And they'll rebel completely against it. And they'll just end up in the same problem in a different direction. They'll end up rejecting that. But they'll be just as out of balance, only in a different area. And so we need to understand the magnitude of life and how it affects a broad spectrum of people and organizations and all of that kind of thing. Another issue is that we need to see our priorities. We're going to do a whole thing about talking about our priorities and finding out those things that are the most important. But the primary issue here is priorities. We need to find out what is important. Because if we don't have a good understanding of what is important in our lives, we are going to spend our time not on those things that are important, but those things that are either expedient, personally expedient for us, or those things that are urgent. We're going to end up spending our time and getting out of balance because we're going to be doing those things that are fun or the things that bring us the most immediate pleasure or those kinds of things. Or we're going to end up spending our time on those things that are urgent that we've let get out of control. And because they're out of control, they control us. And now we're out of control and we have no balance and we have no peace and we have no emotional balance and intellectual balance and those kinds of things. No inward peace. And the last thing is I want to give us, as a primary issue, some tools to live these issues out. It's just some basic ideas on ways that you can go ahead and apply immediately into your life that if you do it, both short-term and long-term, will take that chaotic life and will start redirecting that ship, and it'll bring it back into balance and start setting it on a course to a better life. The first thing we need to do is we need to take an evaluation. Whenever you're going to try and redirect your life, or you're going to try and change your life or better your life, you need to evaluate where you're at. And so what I need you to do is you need to get a piece of paper and a pencil. If you need to stop this right now, you can do that. Go get yourself a piece of paper and a pencil. don't need a whole lot, but you're going to need to be able to sit down and to write some things out. I want you to take some time to be alone and to evaluate the areas of your life or your lives if you're doing this as a couple, with a friend. Maybe you're doing it as a staff or a team or organization. What you're going to do is you're going to sit down, you're going to evaluate. And you're going to evaluate in some different categories. I'm going to give you the categories. I'm going to talk just a little bit about them. I want you to do two things as you do this, as you evaluate. You're going to be able to look at this and kind of see what areas of your life you need to make some changes in and that kind of thing. The first thing you're going to do is you're going to take the numbers 1 through 10. And what you're going to do is 1 means that you are completely out of balance in this area. And 10 means you are perfectly in balance. You think that you're right on. You're giving just the right amount of time, just the right amount of energy, just the right amount of emotional energy and all that stuff to it. So 1 is you're really bad at it, and 10 is you're really good at it. And you want to think about this in your own context, not the way that you think other people ought to think or that kind of thing. Don't define yourself by somebody else. But in terms of your own knowledge of where you're at in your own life and what your life could be and what you want your life to be, people who are later on in life, maybe the kids are already gone to college or that kind of thing, they're going to have different priorities and balance is going to look differently to them than people who have, say, 3 kids under the age of 8. Your life is going to be drastically different and balance is going to look different to you than it is to somebody in a different life situation. So be thinking about it in your own context. And as your life changes, you're going to want to go back and constantly be reevaluating and bringing your life back into balance. So that's the first thing, 1 through 10. 1 is really bad, 10 is really good. Then the second thing I want you to do is just write a brief paragraph about why you answered each of these things that way. You know, why did you put down that you were a 1 instead of a 10 or a 3 or a 7? And that'll just bring to the forefront of your mind some thought. It'll give you some reflection and that kind of thing. So let's get going. I'm going to give you a number of categories here and just want you to write these things down and give yourself a score. The first one is business and professional. In your business and professional life, would you be a 1 or a 10 or somewhere in between? This includes your work life, includes how much time you're spending at work. It includes how much energy it's taking from you and that kind of thing. So just give yourself a brief score on your business and professional life. Are you in balance or are you out of balance? The second category is personal finance. This is not your business budget or anything like that. It's your personal finance. How are you doing financially in regard to your goals, in regard to balance? Are you a 1, are you a 10, are you somewhere in between? You have a lot of debt, or do you have some good savings? Are you able to give to charity the kinds of finances you want to give to charity? Are you able to take care of your family the way you want to be able to take care of your family? How are you at with your personal finances? Now, the next two are for people primarily who are married. The first one being a marriage relationship. How is your marriage relationship? Are you feeling a sense of love and partnership with your spouse? Are you feeling good things? Are you able to spend as much time as you want to be able to spend? Do you still get a spring in your step when you see your spouse come through the door? Does your heart leap a little bit when you see your husband or your wife come through the door? How is your marriage relationship? Are you in balance there? Are you doing what you want to be doing in your marriage relationship? The next one is your relationship with your children. Obviously, these relationships change from the little kids to the big kids, but how is your relationship with your children? You know, some of you may have grown children who you are alienated from, who you are completely out of balance. Maybe you haven't talked to your kids in years. Maybe you're out of balance in a way in that you're taking care of your kids to the point where, you know, they're 38 and they're still living at home. That's out of balance. You know, we need to help those kids get out and get into their own housing, raise their own families. How's your relationship with your kids? Do you have love? Is there mutual respect? Are you in balance or are you out of balance? Well, whether you're married or not, we can talk about the next one, and that is extended family. These would be brothers and sisters and parents and cousins and people who are designed to have relationship with long term. You know, you can choose your friends, you can't choose your family. And we have people in our lives who are our family. And are you in balance with them? Now, obviously, you're going to be closer to some than others, and that's okay, and that's not necessarily out of balance. But, you know, are you in the kind of relationship with the people in your family that you need to be? What about friendships? Scale of 1 to 10, where are you at there? Are you in balance? Are you out of balance? Are you able to spend time with your friends? Do you have one or two close friends who you're able to share important milestones and events, who you're able to go to and seek counsel from, and people who will be honest with you and blunt with you, who will tell you that you're doing great, but will also tell you, you know, you need to change that. It's not good for you. It's not good for your family, not good for your business. What about your friendships? Are you in balance there? Another one is hobbies and recreation. You know, we need to spend time recreating. If you break that word down, it's recreating ourselves. We get burned out when we spend too much time working and giving ourselves to things that drain us emotionally, intellectually, and those kinds of things. Are you taking the time that you want to for your hobbies and for your recreation and re-energizing yourself and reinvigorating yourself so that you're able to be the kind of person that you want to be? What about physical health and physical satisfaction? Are you satisfied with where you are physically? Or is that an area that you're out of balance in? You need to spend a little bit more time, a little bit more energy, maybe a little bit more money to get yourself back into good physical health. Part of a balanced life is to be in good physical health, because being in good physical health will help you professionally. It'll help you relationally. It'll help you in a lot of different ways to become better than you are, and a better life, and you'll achieve a longer life and that kind of thing. Where are you at physically? In balance, out of balance? Another one is emotional health and satisfaction. Are you satisfied with where you're at emotionally? We're talking about the inner part of us, the thoughts, the emotions, the great and grand scale of emotions that we're able to feel, from joy and sorrow and anger and compassion and courage and fear and all the things that provide us with the spice of life, so to speak. How are you feeling emotionally? Do you feel like you're in a good spot, or do you feel like maybe you need to work on that? Evaluate yourself, 1 to 10. The next one, intellectual health and satisfaction. You know, a lot of times we get so caught up in working and the day-to-day grind that we sort of stop challenging ourselves intellectually like we did all the time growing up. You know, from the time we're 5 or 6 years old, we're growing intellectually all the way through college, and some people go to graduate school, and there's just that great sense of growth that takes place in our life as we're growing intellectually. You know that feeling that you feel when you learn a new concept, and it happens intellectually, but it affects us emotionally and physically when we're growing intellectually. And we're going to talk in this whole discussion about how we're intertwined with all the emotions and the intellect and the body and the spirit and all that. How are you intellectually? Are you growing intellectually? What about spiritually? You know, we are spiritual beings, and I want to ask you just bluntly, how are you doing spiritually? Are you where you want to be? Are you out of balance, or are you in balance spiritually? We need to reflect and evaluate our lives and find out from time to time, where are we at? Do we need to put more time, more effort into growing spiritually, or are we in a good place? One other thing that I want us to look at is what I call the strength of your willpower. That is your ability to function with self-control. Because I found when I work with people that one of the first things to go when we get out of balance is our ability to exercise our will. So evaluate that. Am I a person who's able to exercise my willpower? It's one of the greatest gifts we as people have as compared to animals. Animals which operate on instinct and people which are able to operate on choice and self-control by the power of our willpower to be able to make decisions which are good for us, which bring our lives into balance. Scale of 1 to 10, are you able to exercise the strength of your will, the ability to function with self-control? The last one is social and service commitments. You know, one of the things that I feel like a successful person is a person who will give themselves not only to those things that are personally beneficial, which are fine things to do, but also those things that are socially beneficial. These are the service commitments that we make, getting involved with organizations that are changing the world for the better, whether it's locally or nationally or internationally. Are you able to give the kind of time that you want to give to those things? So sit down, and maybe you just need to turn this off right now and go down and spend some time under each one of those subheadings and give yourself a score, 1 to 10. Don't just do it on a cursory level. I know that it's easy for us to just, well, I'm a 7, I'm a 4, I'm a 2, or whatever. But take some time. Really think about it. As you think about each section, gauge yourself as how it interacts with the other sections, how it pulls away from the other sections, the other subheadings. Really give this some thought and jot yourself down a paragraph or two where you're at, where you want to be. Spend some time with this right now. Okay, and then once you're done with that evaluation, let's just go back through it a little bit. What areas are you out of balance in? Go back and look through and see how they interconnect. Take all the ones that you're out of balance in and look at them. What areas are you out of balance in? What areas are you in balance in? What areas are you doing well at? These are some things you ought to give yourself a little pat on the back for getting those things in balance. See how they relate. What areas are strengths of yours? What areas do you need to improve in? As you thought about it, were there any surprises? As you gave it some thought and really saw how your life really is, did you say to yourself, wow, I guess I wouldn't have previously defined myself as being out of balance, but when I look at it, I really am out of balance. Take some time, look through that, and that'll give you a good starting point as we go through the rest of this session on what areas to look at as you apply these basic principles. It's a question we need to ask ourselves, and that is, what causes people to become unbalanced? What are the things that cause us to be out of balance? Well, there's things that are internal, what I call internal pressures, and then there's things that I call external pressures. And you could probably think of a number of them if you just sat down and thought, okay, what is it internally, those things that are happening inside of me that cause me to get out of balance? And then what are some things that are external pressures, things that are happening outside of me that are pulling me and prodding me and pushing me and yelling at me to get me out of balance? This is a very important question for us because it gets to the root of the cause of what causes us to become unbalanced. I want to give you some internal pressures that I think are pretty universal, things that a lot of people experience. The first one that causes us to be out of balance internally is personal expediency or personal satisfaction. We end up doing things that feel good. We are essentially people who seek pleasure and ease. And if we aren't focused in on creating balance, we will tend to drift toward personal expediency or personal satisfaction. And oftentimes that will drag us off out of balance, and we won't be giving the kind of time, effort, energy, and emotional energy into the things that are really the good things of life. So you might ask yourself, am I involved in anything, or am I experiencing internal pressure of personal expediency or personal satisfaction? Another one is a lot of us have something to prove. It's an internal drive of something to prove. Now, I want to tell you a story about a friend of mine. He's a highly successful salesperson in one of the largest corporations in America, one of the fastest growing and largest corporations. He manages a sales team of about 16 people who sell hundreds of millions of dollars worth of product every year. And when he first got into the business, he was hired in and he went to the guy who was overseeing him, and he knew that he was going to have to start hiring salespeople, and he wanted to hire successful salespeople. So he went to this person who he was reporting to, and he said, "You know, you've been in this longer than me. Tell me, what is it that makes a good salesperson? Is it good communication skills? Is it good presentation skills? What do you look for? What's the key thing that you look for when you are looking for a person who will produce and be a good salesperson?" And he said he was shocked at the answer that the person gave, although looking back on it in hindsight, he sees that it really was true, although it was a little warped, it was true. The person said to him, "You want to know what I look for as the primary thing? I interview people and I ask them all the standard questions. You know, what kind of experience do you have and what would you do if you went on this sales call?" But he said, what the primary thing that I look for is I ask them questions, just general questions about their family. And I ask them, you know, what was life like growing up for you and where did you grow up? And he says, "Tell me a little bit about your mom." He says, "But the key that I look for is the answer to this question. Tell me about your relationship with your dad." And he says to my friend, he says, "I always look for the dad wound. That's what makes a good salesperson." Now, that can be kind of ugly, and it is kind of sad that so many of us experience that kind of thing. But the truth is that what this man realized was that people who would drive themselves out of control to make a sell, to spend all their time selling and to give everything and anything, he predominantly found that a lot of them had this internal dad wound. They were trying to prove something to dad. That's an internal pressure that we create for ourselves to try to prove something. Oftentimes it's not our dad, it's to society, it's to a teacher who said that we'd never amount to anything, but it's an internal pressure that we ought to deal with, we ought to remove from ourselves, that causes us to get out of balance. We spend so much time working or doing different things that we neglect the other areas of our lives. And so we need to look internally. Am I being driven by something to prove? Am I being driven by a dad wound or a teacher wound or a voice from the past that we're trying to prove something to? Often, we're unable to ever prove that to someone. Oftentimes, our dads, our moms, our teacher, they'll die and they're not even around anymore. And yet we're spending time trying to prove something to them. Do you have that internal pressure? If you do, I want to encourage you to take a deep look at that and take steps to get out of that. The last internal pressure is closely related, but it's an emotional need for approval. Oftentimes, we allow ourselves to get pulled out of balance because we want the person who will benefit from our being out of balance to approve of us. It might be a boss. It might be a parent. It might be a spouse. It might be someone who's running that service organization who, you know, is laying something on you, a guilt trip to get you involved or whatever. But we allow ourselves to be baited into those things because we have an emotional need for approval. We want people to think we're good people. And yet that can be a real key if we're not careful with that, to being taken out of balance and into that chaotic life that ultimately is going to destroy us. See, we're going to be healthier for work. We're going to be healthier for our family. We're going to be healthier for service organizations and the different groups that we're involved in if we're in balance. We're actually going to produce more over the long haul if we're in balance. We're going to be able to sell more and to create more and to raise healthier children if we ourselves are in balance. So we need to take a close look at those internal pressures. The next thing we need to look at is external pressures and how we relate to those things. One of the first things that I see when I'm working with people that causes external pressure is financial obligations, primarily debt. If you want to get out of the chaotic life, one of the first and foremost things you can do is to eliminate financial obligations and debt. In fact, I think people ought to do the best that they can to live debt-free. You'll see on our website some articles, and we have different resources available for you to find financial freedom. Because if we want to live a balanced life, we've got to have financial freedom, because what obligation financially does, what debt does, is it pulls us into the chaotic life. If you owe a bunch of money and you're trying to spend more time with your family, you are naturally going to be drawn toward working more and earning more, and that's going to create conflict. It's going to create outer conflict. It's going to create emotional conflict. It's going to create spiritual conflict for you. So external pressure of financial obligation and debt needs to be eliminated. Now, oftentimes that's driven by an internal pressure, which is greed or materialism or thinking that someone else will think more highly of you if you have greater toys and those kinds of things. But that's a whole nother story. Financial obligation and debt, one of the biggest things. Another external pressure is relationship expectations. We all have these expectations. Bosses expect us to be at work 40 hours a week. Spouses expect us to take time, to spend time with them, to talk with them. Children expect us to take time to go out and throw the ball with them or go to their recital or whatever it is. There are expectations, and many of them are legitimate expectations. If your boss is going to pay you $75,000 a year, they expect you, rightfully so, to come and put your time in. Your spouse and kids, they have legitimate expectations of you. But these are external pressures that, when taken to the extreme, can pull us out of our balanced life. I'll give you a great example. A friend of mine, I'm very proud of him. He was recently making a change in his career. He was leaving one career and going into another career, and he was offered the CFO job of a very prestigious group. Anybody locally here to my area would know the group, and anybody nationally would most likely know the group, and internationally you might even know the group. But it was a big job, paid a lot of money. But the president, who was hiring him basically to work right alongside with him, said, "You're going to work 80 hours a week." And my friend said to him, "No, I'm not going to work 80 hours a week. I got family. I got kids, and I'm in this time of my life where I'm not going to do it." And the guy said, "Well, you are going to work this. I'm offering you the job, and if you want the job, you're going to have to work it." Well, my friend turned him down and said, "No, that's not where I'm at." And I got to tell you, I was really proud, because this position would have brought him a great financial reward, would have given him a lot of prestige, and would have given him a lot of things that a lot of people sell themselves into. But when he looked at it, he said, "I am not going to give in to the external pressure of relationship expectations, of boss expectations, those kinds of things. I'm going to keep my life in balance." And he's found another job. He's very happy. He earns a great living. And he's able to keep his life in balance, be involved in the organizations he wants to be involved in, be able to spend the time with his wife and his kids. And that's great. We also have social and service obligations and expectations. Again, things that are good, but we have got to keep them in their proper concern. I know a lot of people that I see that are just involved, and I just say to myself, you know, when are you spending time with your family? When are you spending time to work out? When are you spending time to keep your life into balance? And they're off saving the world, and they lose their very own family. And so these are internal and external pressures. And here's the question I want to ask you. You can probably come up with your own, both internal and external. But the key is this. This question: which of these can be changed or overcome? Now, initially, you probably think to yourself, well, the internal pressures are the ones that I can personally change or overcome. But the reality is that we can change and overcome internal and external pressures. We need to take responsibility for our lives and understand that we're the ones who control the destiny of our lives. We're the ones who control whether or not our lives are going to be in balance or out of balance. Now, you might say, well, what if my boss says to me, you can't leave, you need to work? Well, you know what? If you say to yourself, I'm out of balance because my boss says, who has the power there? Your boss has the power. But the reality is that you have the power. You have the ability to make that choice, to make that decision, to take that choice. You have every right in the world to say, you know what, boss? I'm not going to work that many hours. And if that means I'm not going to have that job, then that's okay. I'm fine with that. And the freedom that you will experience when you take control and take responsibility over that is just tremendous and astronomical to be able to say, you know what? I don't have to put my fate into the hands of somebody else. I can go ahead and choose another job. And if someone else chooses to work those kinds of hours and do those kinds of things, then that's great. That's their choice. But my choice is I can change and overcome both the internal pressures and the external pressures. Now, you might see that I'm continually going back to work and finances and those things. It's because as I've worked with people, I find that those tend to be the areas that draw us the most out of balance. And so you'll see that I keep going back into those areas. These are the questions we need to ask ourselves. What causes us to become unbalanced? And as we see the internal pressures and the external pressures, we need to recognize them. But then we also need to say to ourselves, you know what? I'm going to take responsibility. I'm going to take charge. I know that I can change. I know that I can change the course of my life. I know that I can overcome the pressures and the obligations, and I can bring balance into my chaotic life.